The Supreme Court heard oral arguments today in a historic case that would decide whether Donald Trump is disqualified from the ballot based on the 14th Amendment's insurrectionist clause. For more on this, it's time for a closer look. Before today's Supreme Court hearing, Trump had already been through multiple civil trials for fraud, defamation, and sexual abuse. And during those trials, he's had a habit of freely coming and going whenever he wants. He basically turned them into campaign appearances by holding press conferences inside the courthouse or dramatically storming out in the middle of the trial. Then there was the time he got yelled at by a judge for straying off topic during his testimony and then walked out and mimed zipping his lips for the assembled reporters. Trump zipping his lips is so funny because you know he can only go a couple of seconds before unzipping them again. He should combine the two motions. What do I think of the judge? I'll never tell. He is treating me very unfairly. Did he see? He did it. But Trump did not have the option to turn today's Supreme Court proceedings into a campaign event. Instead, he was at Mar-a-Lago, where he did a radio interview about the case. And without any sense of irony or self-awareness, he claimed it would be an attack on democracy to remove him from the ballot for attacking democracy.
They want to have, you know, the Supreme Court rule or vote to take me out of the race. That would be a very terrible thing to do. It's about the vote. It's about our Constitution. You can't take the votes away from the people. That would be so bad for democracy.
That's what you did. That's why this case is happening in the first place. It's like if OJ had gotten up in court and said, if you put me in jail, you'll be murdering my freedom. With ill-fitting gloves, no less. One of two things is possible. Either Trump is a shameless, pathological liar who projects his crimes onto others, or he has what's known in the medical community as 51st dates disease, where he wakes up every day and forgets what happened the day before. That would explain why Trump makes as much sense at his rallies as an Adam Sandler character.
Ding, 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 pshin, poom.
Now, during today's hearing, yeah, we can clap it up for Sandman. During today's hearing, the justices seemed supportive of Trump and very skeptical of throwing him off the ballot, which was expected, given that Trump appointed three of the justices on the court and another three are staunch conservatives, like Clarence Thomas, who is somehow still involved in this case despite the fact that his wife, Ginny Thomas, played a role in the January 6th coup attempt. In fact, she personally lobbied state lawmakers in Wisconsin and Arizona to overturn the election results and repeatedly texted Trump's chief of staff at the time, Mark Meadows, about some truly unhinged conspiracy theories.
The Washington Post obtained copies of messages that had been turned over to the January 6th committee, revealing that Ginny Thomas sent former Trump chief of staff Mark Meadows a barrage of texts in the weeks after the 2020 election, urging him to try to overturn the results.
Right after the election, she quoted to Meadows the language then circulating on pro-Trump sites, quote, Biden crime family and ballot fraud co-conspirators, elected officials, bureaucrats, social media censorship mongers, fake stream media reporters, etc., are being arrested and detained for ballot fraud right now and over coming days and will be living in barges off Gitmo to face military tribunals for sedition, adding, I hope this is true.
Not only should Clarence Thomas recuse himself from this case, Ginny Thomas should recuse herself from texting on her phone. Ginny, what are you smiling at over there? Oh, just writing something funny about Gitmo. She thought the, quote, Biden crime family was being arrested for ballot fraud and would be detained on barges off Guantanamo Bay. Here's my question. Why barges? Why couldn't the Biden crime family just be detained on land? Why do they have to be on water? Is the idea here that Biden could never escape because he can't swim? I mean, look, if you surrounded Trump with a one-foot-wide moat, I think he would die there. But Biden definitely strikes me as one of those old guys who spends hours doing laps at the Y with his little paddleboard and swim cap. He's there at 6 a.m. sharp, swims for an hour, and then spends another 2 hours air-drying his junk in the locker room. You know those old guys who love to just hang out in the locker room completely naked while they do other stuff. Sometimes I swear I've seen a bunch of naked 80-year-olds in a semicircle during their weekly book club in there. Then they just finish and use their balls as a bookmark. Seriously. How is it possible that Thomas has not recused himself from this case? His spouse was directly involved. It'd be like if I told a joke in my monologue about a Florida woman who tried to smuggle meth onto a flight inside a pet snake, but didn't tell you that woman was my wife, and the meth was mine. Now you know why I talk so fast. Trump and his legal team seemed well aware of their inherent advantage going into this case. And Fox News, one of Trump's lawyers, Alina Habba, went out of her way to name check Justice Brett Kavanaugh as someone Trump was counting on to rule in his favor.
I think it should be a slam dunk in the Supreme Court. I have faith in them. You know, people like Kavanaugh, who the president fought for, who the president went through hell to get into place, he'll step up. Those people will step up.
She's talking about a Supreme Court justice the way a mobster talks about one of his street captains. We need someone to take out the Russians. Don't worry, Kavanaugh will step up. He owes us for the thing with the guy in the thing. Now, as you may recall, the Colorado Supreme Court ruled that Trump was ineligible for the ballot based on the 14th Amendment's Insurrectionist Clause, which bars anyone who takes an oath to uphold the Constitution, but then engages in insurrection or rebellion against the U.S. from holding state or federal office. The amendment was ratified after the Civil War to bar former Confederates from serving in government because after the war, southern states immediately started sending unrepentant traitors back to Congress. As one historian explained, they lose in April of 1865, but by December of 1865, they're sending back to Congress people like Alexander Stevens, the former vice president of the Confederacy. It's unbelievable they thought they could do that. They're completely unrepentant, and they are used to exercising power. That sounds like it could be Donald Trump's Tinder bio. Completely unrepentant, used to exercising power, hates dogs. So it seems pretty obvious that the language of the 14th Amendment would apply to Trump's behavior on and leading up to January 6th, but there are several other key issues being litigated here. For example, Trump's lawyer, Jonathan Mitchell, argued that the president is somehow not an officer of the United States as specified in the 14th Amendment, meaning the text doesn't apply to Trump, only to other officers of the government. Justice Sonia Sotomayor pointed out during oral arguments today that this would create a very convenient loophole for Donald Trump.
Your principal argument is that the president is not an officer of the United States, correct?
Yeah, I would say it a little more forcefully than what Your Honor just described. We believe the presidency is excluded from office under the United States, but the argument we have that he's excluded the president as an officer of the United States is the stronger of the two textually and has fewer implications for other constitutions.
Bit of a gerrymandered rule, isn't it, designed to benefit only your client?
I certainly wouldn't call it gerrymandered.
It is funny to imagine that the drafters of the 14th Amendment somehow specifically exempted Donald Trump of all people. That would explain why they added a clause saying any person who engages in insurrection shall be barred from office unless said person is a boisterous and irksome real estate financier with peculiar physical features and a bizarre obsession with winged creatures slain by a wind-producing apparatus who once hosted a reality competition program on television or whatever that is. And then under questioning from Justice Elena Kagan, Mitchell later seemed to concede that it would be very weird if the drafters of the 14th Amendment had somehow created a super narrow loophole that would allow a former president who engaged in insurrection to avoid being disqualified.
It does seem as though there's no particular reason, and you can think of lots of reasons for the contrary,
right,
to say that the only people who have engaged in insurrection who are not disqualified from office are presidents who have not held high office before. Why would that rule exist?
Yeah. I don't think there is a good rationale given that this was compromised legislation. It does seem odd that President Trump would fall through the cracks, in a sense.
It's not great when, as a lawyer, you just admit in court that your argument is weird. It's like if Spirit's slogan was, "We're a little funky, but we're cheap." For the most part, the court avoided getting into the actual facts of what happened on January 6th, and the justices didn't seem especially interested in litigating the question of whether Trump had actually engaged in an insurrection, although at one point, Trump's lawyer conceded something pretty eye-opening, something that Trump himself has never conceded, that the events of January 6th were violent, criminal, and wrong.
For an insurrection, there needs to be an organized, concerted effort to overthrow the government of the United States through violence. And this riot
the point
occurred,
is that a chaotic effort to overthrow the government is not an insurrection?
No, we didn't concede that it's an effort to overthrow the government either, Justice Jackson, right? None of these criteria were met. This was a riot. It was not an insurrection. The events were shameful, criminal, violent, all of those things, but it did not qualify as insurrection, as that term is used in Section 3.
Something tells me Trump isn't exactly going to be thrilled with that argument. It doesn't really fit on a baseball cap. Shameful, criminal, violent, but still eligible. After oral arguments, Trump immediately appeared outside Mar-a-Lago to offer comments, which news networks thought would be about the Supreme Court case. But when it became clear he was just going to lie uninterrupted and ramble about himself, CNN cut away.
You wouldn't have any of the problems that we have today. And you certainly had a broke Iran, and now you have a very rich Iran. Iran was broke when I left. They had no money to give to Hamas. They had no money
okay,
to give to
Hezbollah. I think we've gotten all the legal analysis we're going to get out of President Trump.
It's never a good idea to tune into a Trump speech expecting cogent legal analysis. He just wants the cameras on him. In fact, I think we should put a fake camera on him at all times that's not actually plugged into anything. And there's a good chance he'll just stand there rambling until he falls asleep. The border is a mess. Migrants are making a run for the border, just like Taco Bell. You know, that used to be their slogan. Make a run for the border, now it's Liv Moss. I like the dog. Little dog, tiny dog, but he had a deep voice. He had a big, deep voice. He said, yo quiero Taco Bell, and we love that. No one knew what it meant. No way to find out. No way to find out, but we loved it. We loved it, didn't we? Think outside the bun, that was another. But then a few minutes later, CNN cut back to Trump because they thought he was talking about the Supreme Court case again, only to cut away immediately again when he rambled off topic.
I'm being told Donald Trump is talking about legal matters, so let's listen.
It's election interference, and it's really very sad. I thought the presentation today was a very good one. Many terrorists are coming into our country. We're going to be paying a big price. They have to stop it. They have to close the border. By the way, the president can do it just by saying, I want the border.
Okay, let's break away from the former president.
I feel so bad for the CNN producer in the studio whose job it was to monitor the feed. All right, no, he's talking about the court. Cut back to him. Never mind. He's talking about how he hates dogs. Cut away. Whoa. He's back to the court stuff. You can go to him. Oh, wait. Now he's talking about a sexy yacht party he attended in the 80s. Cut away and put an R rating on the screen. And then, you guys, it happened a third time.
John, I need to interrupt you. I'm sorry, because former President Trump is taking questions. I'm told we should
All right. Run that. I got the gist.
No question.
Yeah, I got the gist. They're stealing our business. They're taking our business at levels that nobody's ever seen before. By doing that, we bring business
back. All right, it's turned back into a campaign appearance.
Trump could just keep tricking CNN into taking his comments live by saying the word Supreme Court over and over. Supreme Court, Supreme Court, Supreme Court. Are the cameras on me now? Biden's a criminal witch hunt. The border windmill's killing me. Cameras are gone. They're gone again. Supreme Court, Supreme Court, Supreme Court. Oh, they're back. Hillary's emails. Where's Hunter? Toilets don't flush anymore. To any sensible person who watched the events of January 6th unfold in real time, who's considered all the evidence about Trump's coup attempt and who's read the plain text of the Constitution, there's no question Trump tried to engage in insurrection and that the 14th Amendment does apply to him. But we didn't get a real hearing of the issues. At the heart of this case today, because most of the justices had clearly already made up their minds, today's hearing probably wouldn't have gone much differently if Trump's lawyer had just stood up, addressed the court, and said this.
Ding, 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 pshin, poom.
This has been A Closer Look. Hey, everybody, thanks for watching A Closer Look. And as a reminder, my brother Josh and I have started a new podcast called Family Trips with the Myers Brothers. We hope you listen. We hope you like it. And see you soon.